there. Is today your first time here? Or maybe your first time in a while? If so, maybe you're wondering exactly who we are and what this church is all about. Well, we'd like you to know that we're a group of ordinary people who are on an amazing journey together, following Christ. Our guide is the Bible, because it's the divinely inspired word of God, and it will never take us in the wrong direction. Along the way, we hope you'll see that we are welcoming and spiritually passionate, and that getting to know you is a big deal to us. We know that the road is rough sometimes, but we'll work really hard to bring you practical and relevant messages to equip and encourage you through life's ups and downs. We want you to know that we care about this community, and we believe that it's our job to make it a better place. So, no matter who you are or where you've been, we're glad you're here with us today. And we hope that you'll join us on our journey, following Christ and living out His plan for us. So, welcome to church.
Good morning and welcome. We are so glad that you have chosen to worship with us this morning, whether you are here in person or joining us online. My name is Ed Yeager, and I'm the family pastor here. And as we begin, I just want to share a couple announcements with you to kind of keep you up with what's happening here in our church. First of all, the men's ministry is participating in a series called 33, and it's a Saturday mornings, and Bobby Boyd, our men's ministry director, is leading that. And it's a great opportunity to connect with some other men. This is, I hear, a great series to be a part of. And if you're interested in being a part of that, let us know. But they meet Saturday mornings at 8 a.m. here in our loft. And so it's a great opportunity to connect with some other people and be a part of a great group and what Bobby is doing here with our men. Also, if you are not receiving our weekly emails, we are sending out emails almost daily just to connect with everybody who is a part of the church. It gives you an opportunity to see prayer requests, know how you can pray for our church, but it also gives you an opportunity to know what's happening. We share announcements, things like that. So you'll definitely want to be a part of that. If you have not received those emails, you can send us an email at admin@clarksvillefirst.com, and we will add you to our email list, and that way you can stay connected with what's happening in our children's ministry, our youth ministry, college ministry, adult ministry, women, men, whatever. So you'll definitely want to be a part of that. Also, for those of you that are joining us in worship today, on the far left side of your row, there is a connection book. We'd love for you to fill that out. It gives us a record of your visit, but there's also an opportunity for you to fill in prayer requests. And just so you know, we share those with the community here. Your staff prays for you. And so we would love to know how best we can serve you and pray with you. Those books are there. If you're at the table, there's a sheet there for you as well. And we just want to be able to have chances to connect with you and find out what's going on and how we can best serve you as we minister here at this church. Also, there will not be a regular tithe and offering during the service, but there are tithe buckets that are placed by the exits. You can just drop your tithes and offerings off there on your way out. And there are online giving options as well. You can do that through our website. There's also a text option that's available there. So if you visit our website, all the instructions are there to make that happen. And I just want to say thank you very much, church. You have been generous to us and to this church. And it's allowed us to continue ministry throughout this season. And in the midst of this, we have not had to just stop doing what we're doing. We have continued to offer programming for children, youth, adults, in the midst of this, and doing it in the very best way possible, and trying to do that safely. So thank you, church, for your generosity and your faithfulness. As we were preparing for church, and we gathered in prayer ahead of time, Jay, our worship leader, kind of mentioned something, and it just reminded me of this verse from Psalms 122, and it says, "I rejoice with those who said to me, 'Let us go into the house of the Lord.'" And to me, I was just excited to be back today. And I don't know about you, but I am excited to be in the house of the Lord. So let's worship this morning.
Amen. Thank you, Pastor Ed. I'm excited to be here as well, if you'll stand with us this morning. You know, I was just thinking as we're getting ready to go into this first song, the last time that I went to the beach and I stood in the ocean, as the waves, they would crash across my feet, the sand would just wash out and I would begin to sink, and I would sink more. You know, and those of us who are believers, we have Jesus Christ that we're standing on in our faith and in our lives. You know, our feet are on the rock of God and His salvation. my feet are on the rock today. So let's just remember that and put our hands together as we get ready. As we get ready to give him worship. I can see the clouds rolling. We can do better than that. I can feel the waters rise. I can hear the howling lies that haunt. Fear won't hold me now. My feet are on the rock. When I feel my hope about to break, I will give to you. Clap of praise this morning, for he is worthy. He's worthy of our praise. Amen. Lord, we just ask you to come in this place. Lord, we ask that you would come and just flow, Lord, and that you would be like a tidal wave. That you would come out. I'm not afraid to die. Exodus 34 and 6, this isn't on the screen, I'm sorry. The Lord God, merciful and gracious, long-suffering, and abounding in goodness and truth. Our God this morning, He is so good. You know, I was talking again to the team earlier, and you know, God is good even when we're not. God is good even when we deny Him. You know, I don't know how you may be feeling today. You may be having a great day. You may be having a great year. You may be scared or unsettled. But, you know, there may be things hidden in our hearts even that has us worried. But, you know, nothing is hidden from God. No, He is faithful. He is full of goodness. His mercy endures. We can just give Him the praise and give Him honor because of His goodness.
Moment.
Lord, we just welcome you here. We give you all praise, Lord, for you are so worthy. How great is your love today? How great are you? From the darkness, I called your name. Into darkness, your mercy came. You called me out, lifted me up. How great is your love? You bore my weakness, you took my shame, buried my burdens in fields of grace. You called me out, lifted me up.
isn't this our prayer this morning, of how great God's love is? It's a love that we just can't fathom. You know, I kind of think about things that, you know, I've done wrong in the past and how I've messed things up. And God still loves me. That God still cares about me. That God still wants the best for me. Isn't that great? You know, how often do we have people in our lives that sometimes when we mess up, they're just done with us? But that's not God. He's standing there ready to forgive us, ready to welcome us back in those times when we just haven't done it right. And that's why we worship Him this morning. And this morning, as we're gathering here together as families, in our homes gathered together as families, we're going to take a moment to just lift our voices to God, to remind ourselves and to proclaim how great our God is. Let's pray this morning. Dear Lord, we just thank You for who You are. I thank You that You are so great. The God, creator of the universe, wants the very best for me, wants the very best for this church, wants the very best for our families, and knows each and every one of us by name. Lord, You truly are great. Lord, as the scripture reminds us, there is no one that compares to You. We try sometimes and we just always fail, but we know that You are never failing. That You're always going to be there to love us and to care for us and provide for us, and we just thank You for that. Lord, this morning as we're here in worship, we just pray that the songs that would be sung, the things that would be done, the word that would be preached would be to honor You and to point people back to You, so that not only ourselves we would see how great You are, but others would as well. Lord, we just thank You. Lord, this morning as we're gathered here together, I know that there are prayer requests. We kind of mentioned some earlier as we were gathered together before the service, Lord. And we know that in this congregation, there is a great need for You. Whether it be a need for healing emotionally or physically, maybe it's just a renewal of a relationship that's been broken. Lord, You know the prayer requests. You know each and every one of them. And Lord, I just pray for each and every one of those requests. I pray that You would go to those that need healing, that You would, as we know You are, be the great physician, provide healing in those situations, whether it be through some miraculous thing or whether it be that You work through doctors and nurses and medicine, Lord. We just want to know that You can do this. We are reminded that You can do this, so we want to give You the glory when that healing happens. Lord, I pray for each and every one of our requests. Lord, I pray for our church this morning as we're trying to navigate a season that we just kind of don't know what to do with, Lord, but we are relying on You, that we're turning to You, seeking Your guidance, and how to be a church that shines in this community so that others would see You. Lord, I pray that You would give us the strength, not only as a church, but as the people of Your church, to be able to live out the calling that You have just placed on each and every one of us. Help us to be the hands and feet for You in this community, in our homes, in our workplaces. Lord, we pray all of these things in the words of Jesus, who taught us to pray. Our Father, who is in heaven, hallowed be Your name. Your kingdom come, Your will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we also have forgiven our debtors. And do not lead us into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For Yours is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
Amen. 1 John 4:18 says, "There is no fear in love, but perfect love casts out fear. Because fear involves punishment, and the one who fears is not perfected in love." When He told you you're not good enough, when He told you you're not right,
when he told you you're not strong enough to put up a good fight, when he told you you're not worthy, when he told you you're not loved, when he told you you're not beautiful, that you'll never be enough.
To worship you and you alone, that that fear wouldn't enter into our hearts and minds and our decision making and our future plans, God, that you are enough, that you give us everything we need, that your love is the only thing that we feel. Lord, we've sang songs this morning that have just expressed and offered praise and love and trust in you. So God, I pray today that as we hear the word together, As we in one heart believe in you for transformation, we believe that you've given us a mission that's greater than anything else the world offers. Lord, the world wants to distract us. The enemy wants to distract us, and he uses the world, he uses us. Father, I pray today that you'd help us as we just sink our hearts and our minds and our efforts and our plans and everything that we have into you. That you would drive that in our lives, that we would trust you beyond any measurable degree of trust, because your ways are much greater, bigger, stronger, more fathomable, unfathomable than we can even think, dream, or imagine. Help us to place our trust in you today, Jesus. It's in your name I pray. Amen. Hey, you may be seated. Well, I'm glad you decided to come today and participate in the gathering of the body in this facility. We have missed you, and I'm sure you have missed being a part of worship and our togetherness. I hope you haven't missed out on much worship, because it's been offered, and even if you don't like our programming, it's being offered in other places. So I hope that you had the opportunity just to soak yourselves and saturate in the Word of God and the truth of who He is, that it doesn't have to come from just one mouthpiece. Amen? Amen. Thank you very much. You're going to have to get a little louder. I know we're all wearing masks this morning, and I appreciate that. I'm going to talk about that in just a second. But I'm just going to need some more help today from you just to affirm those things. So I've been watching a lot of sports this weekend. And now that the kids' sports are done, the college sports are done, the men are playing. And so you may have seen the NFL has picked up the playoffs and all those things. And so I'm amazed how a team that likes to run an offense like the Packers, let's just use them for example, just run an offense through the air, how they've chosen, if the air's not working, they choose to run the ball. There's different avenues to win a game. There's different ways that you can approach a game to win. And if the avenue in which you've planned, prepared, and you've been successful your whole life isn't working, then there's got to be another avenue, right? I mean, that makes sense. That's just simple. That's just practical, that we have to run different avenues. And so in this season, we recognize that things are weird. Things are different, that we're not able to have victory in some of the ways that we've had victory. We're not able to see some of the same success. Oh, by the way, kids, you're dismissed to go. Sorry, I wanted to get my Packer analogy while my family was in the room, while Caleb was still here. But if you want to go and worship with our children's ministry this morning, all of our elementary students are being asked or invited to participate with Miss Deanna. She's at the back door right now. Thank you. We'll see you guys shortly, or after church. However shortly or longly that is, we're going to be there. I love watching our kids go to children's church. So anyway, I just wanted to, I'm saying all that, and I'm sharing all that to say this. We live in a unique season, in a different season, a difficult season right now, as have Christians and believers throughout all of history. You know, we're not the first people ever to be persecuted. You know, we're not the first people ever that have gone through difficult seasons and difficult trials and things of that nature. That's happened throughout all of history. It's not unique to us. And so if you think, man, this is the worst time in life to live, I would rethink that analogy, because guess what? People just like you were fed to lions, okay? People just like you were being put on crosses and lit on fire so that an evil king could ride around his garden and have light. Just remember, there are other times and other seasons of history that were worse than this, but this happens to be our season. And so I think it's important that we rise up in our season. I think it's important that you take the mission more seriously now than you've ever taken the mission in your life. As Christian people, we are called to a higher degree of living. As Christian people, as believers in the name of Jesus Christ, who by the power of the Holy Spirit accomplish the mission of God in this world, we have been called to a higher purpose. We've been called to being set apart. We've been called to an obedience, a mission of obedience that I think is above and beyond what the normal human being today has to live. I just want you to know that. The idea of holiness, the idea of a sanctification, a sanctified life, the idea of, and these are all biblical words, not words I've made up or our denomination has made up. These are biblical words, a word for you this morning, a unique word for you this morning to hear. Hear this word, heed this call. These are the words that the Lord has put on my heart this morning. And I want to talk about integrity today. Church, integrity and character are things that I think that are slipping through our fingers. I think in the world we live in today, we're ready to throw down the gauntlet at anybody who thinks differently than us, or anybody who's shaped differently than us, or anybody who wants to challenge our way of living. Our integrity must be at the foundational piece of foundational whatever the best word possible you can insert there. It's got to be a piece of our lives, not a piece, but the piece of our lives that lives out the calling of Jesus Christ. And so I want to challenge you to a couple things this morning. We have sent out some emails this week. The board and I met this week to discuss how we come back to church and how we pursue the mission together, how we worship together. And I think it's important that you listen to this. I think it's important that you, as followers of Jesus Christ, who are under spiritual authority, who are under authority, Jesus, God put authority in motion. God set up authority, because if there's not order, there's chaos. Authority is important. And so I want you to know, if you like it or you don't like it, I stand before you as your spiritual authority this morning in this church. And our board and our staff are also a part of that spiritual authority. And I want to ask you, there's not a mandate to masks in here. We're not forcing you to wear masks or do something that is cruel or unusual. But I want to share what the board and I sat together and just worked out for, I don't know, seemed like hours. In our conversation together, there was all kinds of thoughts and philosophies and statistics and facts and all kinds of feelings that were brought out. And we wrestled over the idea of what should we do to be together, and we want to be together, and how do we accomplish that, and how do we think about each other, and how do we do something that is beneficial for the kingdom and beneficial for us? How do we live out our mission of loving God and loving people, and how do we think about each other better than ourselves? And we came to the conclusion, no matter how we felt about a decision on one side of the aisle or the other aisle, we felt like we love each other. We love each other deeply, and we want what's best for each other. And whether that's holding out and being out of the program time of worship together for a few weeks so we can get through a season, or whether that's coming in together and just deciding to wear masks for a little while, we want to be together. We want to share the love of Christ together. We want to be in harmony with one another. You know, one of the most disturbing things I've found throughout this whole season, it's been almost a year now, the church has become divisive over things like this. We began to attack each other, and the enemy is having small victories, and he's setting up in our camp, and he's beginning to have victory with you, and we're beginning to shoot at each other, and beginning to criticize each other, and because you don't think like me, and because you don't think like me, you're not doing it right. It's a lie from the enemy, and I think that song was absolutely and totally appropriate. Fear's a liar. I think we live in the midst of fear, and so we begin to make decisions that are best for me and us, and I want to protect myself, and if you don't believe in what I believe in, then you're wrong. There's no room Christianity for that type of thinking. I want to read just a small passage out of Philippians. This is just an announcement, by the way. I want to read a passage out of Philippians, and I want to challenge you with the words that the board and I voted on and chose, elected to be our decision as we move forward as a church. Philippians chapter 2, verse 1 through 11. I know it's quite a bit, and if you'll turn to that with me, that would be awesome, so that you can read these words and you can meditate on these words and you can take them home and you can find holes in them if you want to, but you won't, because it's the truth of the scriptures. This is the heart of what it means to be Christian. Philippians chapter 2, beginning at verse 1, says this: "Therefore, if there is any encouragement in Christ, if there is any consolation of love, if there is any fellowship of the Spirit, if any affection and compassion, make my joy complete by being of the same mind, maintaining the same love, united in spirit, intent on one purpose. Do nothing from selfishness or empty conceit, but with humility in mind, regard one another as more important than yourselves." I want to read that one more time. Verse 3, "Do nothing from selfishness or empty conceit, but with humility of mind, regard one another as more important than yourselves. Do not merely look out for your own personal interests, but also the interests of others." This is in the Bible. You can read this. "Have this attitude in yourselves, which also is in Christ Jesus," "who although he existed in the form of God, did not regard equality with God a thing to be grasped. but emptied himself, taking the form of a bondservant and being made in the likeness of men, submitting himself. Being found in appearance as a man, he humbled himself by becoming obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross. For this reason also, God highly exalted him and bestowed on him the name which is above every name. So that the name of Jesus, every knee will bow, of those who are in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and that every tongue will confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. This is a passage this morning in an announcement to remind you, we are the people of God. We do business different. We think about each other greater than we think about our own selves. Look around you. That person you see around you, you value more than you value yourself. The idea of self-centeredness, the idea of selfishness, the idea of divisiveness comes from my own flesh wanting to be desired. And Paul's words encourage us. Paul's words help us to understand. Think about each other. And so with that in mind, I want to just remind you that while you're in the facility, we're just asking you, strongly encouraging you, to think about each other greater than yourselves. As you walk around hallways, as you mingle together, and it's hard for us not to hug, and that's one of the things that we talked about in the board meeting. It's you can't come to church and say, don't touch each other, don't hug, because we love to hug. We love embracing each other. And so we're just asking you, would you just help us out? Would you just think about each other? I personally am at the top of one of those lists, of the highly vulnerable groups. I had a kidney transplant several years ago. I'm in that group. I guess I'm asking you to think about me. Some of you guys, some of my best friends in here are in those groups, dangerous groups, that if something were to happen to them, man, how would I live with myself? Just because I was thinking about me. So I just want to ask you this morning, and I want to ask the Lord to help us as we continue to move on. We're going to talk about integrity today. We're going to talk about Proverbs today. We're going to talk about wisdom today and living in a way that matches the integrity of who God is. And I want to pray for us as a church. Sometimes we need to have these conversations. Sometimes we need to just be challenged. And myself, I need to be challenged. This is not what I want to do. You ever ate a bag of Doritos and then sat in a mask all day? It's not fun. Even coffee doesn't sit in a mask well all day long. And I can hear myself singing in my own mask more than you can, which maybe is beneficial to you. They're not fun, but I love you. And if we're going to be together, if we're going to worship together, if we're going to open our campus and be together, I believe it's what's best for us. The alternative is not as fun. It's not as good. It's not as meaningful for us as a body of believers. So I just want to say thank you in advance. Father, would you help us this morning? Lord, we've been challenged to a deeper way of living. And not just this morning in my words, but by your words. Your word is truth. And we've sang all morning this morning how good and how kind and how gracious you are and how loving you are. And we want to replicate that in our own lives. And Lord, later we're going to hear that you've challenged us that you're holy, and so we ought to be holy. And so in chasing after you today, God, would you just help us to live out the two greatest commandments that you gave us that sum up all the laws and the prophets? Would you help us to love you with all of our heart, soul, mind, and strength? Would you help us to love our neighbors as ourselves? But we have strong desire to love ourselves. We have a strong need to please ourselves, to be righteous in our own eyes and our own minds. Lord, I pray that we treat others in that same fashion, in that same way. Help us as the church who's been called by your name, uniquely imprinted by you, set apart for your holy purposes. Help us to move forward in harmony today, God. I pray for churches all over the world today, Christian people and believers all over the world today, that your Spirit would convict us and convince us to be better stewards, to be better lovers, to be more generous, to think about others, God, to live out the mission as we celebrate and we advance the kingdom, your kingdom in this world. We love you, Jesus, and we pray these things in your name. Amen. I hope you enjoyed our announcement this morning. I want to move to our sermon. Proverbs is a book that we've been talking about now for several weeks, and it's such a good book. It's such a meaningful book for me. And this, there is a bridge to this, so just hang on. There, Proverbs is a book that that my dad challenged me at an early age, even forced me early on in life to just begin to read through Proverbs. A proverb a day is so beneficial to me in my life, and the wisdom and the knowledge and the understanding that it brings, and the discernment and all of the discipline and everything that Proverbs brings is just an incredible helper for me in my life. And I think it would be a great helper for you. Last year, we began to talk about just making this a yearly, an annual tradition, that every beginning of the year, every new year, starting in January, there's 31 days in January and there's 31 Proverbs. We would just match those days together, and all of our preaching, all of our classes, our discipleship, our teaching, all that stuff would come off of the book of Proverbs, and that we would be inundated as we seek godly wisdom together as a church. That's important for us as we begin a new year, as we look for fresh starts, as we look for, we try to make resolutions, as we're trying to just really have a better year this year than we did last year. That's kind of what the new year just kind of recognizes, that there's a rollover. There's something new. We can start something fresh, and we can be better. And so I think we like those kind of things. I think we like freshness, and we like opportunities to start. All of our weight loss programs seem to begin the same time. We want the fresh start. We want to begin this time, and I can't start eating right in the middle of the week. I got to start eating right on Monday. And so I'm going to stop drinking pop and coke and eating sugar and all these things. I'm going to stop doing that on Monday, because I need the weekend to finish out my routine that I started Monday. I started drinking coke and eating Snickers and all these things last Monday. I got to finish that, and so I got to start it again this week. So I think this Proverbs series is so beneficial. And so if you've kept up, you should be on completing today the 17th chapter of Proverbs and following along in that way. I promise you it will make an impact in your life. Take the Proverb challenge, and it will change and shape your life. It takes 30 days to really take hold of a new habit, to break one or start one. And so I would just challenge you, if you haven't even picked it up yet, just begin for 30 days reading through Proverbs, or begin just reading the scriptures somewhere. Well, Proverbs chapter 6. I don't know that I've ever preached one so with such a difficult name. I don't know that I've ever preached anything this harsh. Today we're going to talk about the seven abominations of God. Yay! This should be fun. And I think it will be. If you'll stand with me this morning, we'll read Proverbs chapter 6, verse 16 through 19 together. Proverbs chapter 6, verse 16 through 19. There are six things which the Lord hates. Yes, seven which are an abomination to him. Haughty eyes, a lying tongue, and hands that shed innocent blood. A heart that devises wicked plans, feet that run rapidly to evil. A false witness who utters lies. And one who spreads strife among brothers. Thank you very much. You may be seated. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. I just want to spend a few minutes talking about this today, because I think it all leads to character. It all leads to integrity. I don't think this is a list that most of you are going, well, I didn't know that. I didn't know you weren't supposed to lie. I didn't know you weren't supposed to shed innocent blood. I didn't know that. This is not a list of like, whoa, I shouldn't be doing those things. I've been participating in all those things thinking I was godly, and all of a sudden Jeremy says, don't do those things, and now I gotta reframe and reshape my life. I think you know this. I think this is something simple for you, something that you've probably been living your life. I can't imagine that most of us, probably all of us, have probably been heeding this instruction, have probably been living our lives recognizing that we shouldn't be arrogant or haughty, or we shouldn't be looking above, like down our nose at people. We shouldn't lift ourselves up. We shouldn't lie to each other or shed blood or devise wicked plans or run into evil or begin to have controversy and strife among our brothers. Those are things we probably know. But I want to take this passage and try to walk us a little bit deeper into the heart of it, into what I really think Solomon is trying to share with us. What I really think is a little bit one more step forward is in this whole conversation. I believe this conversation, this piece, the six things, the seven abominations, these seven things that he talks about have to do with character and integrity, which I think sometimes we do have to come back to, and we have to look, what's the plumb line? Where's the reality and the truth of how do we get off the page so deeply where we get into these things? Because we might not think that we not call ourselves a liar, but it's one step. We're one step from really moving that direction, right? It's like you tell your kids, well, we start being sarcastic, and then you start to joke, and my kids have learned this. I'm not lying, Dad. I'm just joking. Yeah, I know where this leads. I've been that kid, and sometimes I am that kid. I know that our jokes are just used as a defense to hide the fact that we don't want to tell the truth. Amen. I know you're there, too. I know you do it, too. Well, maybe you don't. Lord, forgive me. So I want to keep us away from walking down that road. I want us to hold our integrity in such a way that we're not even willing. Our yes is our yes, and our no is our no's, and we're holding the truth and the plumb line, and what God's telling us and his word is what shapes us and what helps us and what we're obedient to, instead of what man or woman, what human beings sometimes lead us to be. Because if we're not trying to please God, we're trying to please ourselves or each other. So I just want to start with this. God uses, or Solomon uses, some difficult passages or some difficult words to describe his feelings about these seven things. Words that we don't typically like to talk about, we don't like to share, we don't even like to think God hating something, or that God is disgusted by something, or God is repulsed by something. But these are things, the strong words that he used, I think, emphasizes how important our character really is. How important our integrity is, how important our life of holiness really is, and how important it is for us to walk in a way that is a path that trusts God at all times, and in a way that doesn't veer from that we're focused on him at all times. I think these are strong words to denote that this is important. I don't want God to look at me and say, I hate the things that you're doing. I'm disgusted by the things that you're doing. I hate this behavior. This behavior that you're a part of is repulsive to me, and it disgusts me, and it's I can't even look upon it. I can't even handle what you're doing. And if we knew that we were a part of and made decisions and walked in ways and wrote things on social media and we said things to others, or we had an attitude towards others, or we had an arrogance about ourselves that God would say, I hate that, we would never participate. So I want you to understand, God hates these things. He hates this kind of character. He hates this kind of this really, it's not character at all. It's a lessened, it's a second, third, it's a down the list kind of lifestyle that he wants you to live, because he wants you to live a life of holiness. And anything else, any other choice, any other lifestyle that you choose other than holiness is a life that God goes, I hate that life. That's an abomination to me. It disgusts me that you would choose to live that way. These things, thank God, he's a loving God. And he sent Jesus for us. And Jesus sits at the right hand constantly saying, yeah, but that Greg Smith, I know he's a lawyer, but I love him. I want the best for him. Amen. I want what's best for him. And he's got a good heart. He's generous. He's supportive. You got to know I love him. Jesus is our advocate. I came across this quote inappropriately for this weekend. Martin Luther King Jr. had this quote, and I think I think probably many pastors are using Martin Luther King Jr. this weekend, but it's appropriate for today, and it's appropriate for the season I have a dream that for my four little children, that one day they'll live in a nation where they will not be judged by the color of their skin, but by the content of their character. Character means a lot. I guess the question for us today, does character and integrity matter anymore? Does character and integrity mean anything to us anymore? Is it something that we grasp onto and we hold onto, that my character and my integrity mean everything to me, that I'm not willing to compromise my integrity or my character? I'm not willing to compromise any of these things of who God is shaping me to be, the things that he wants me to be to impress people, to impress others, to fulfill my own selfish fleshly desires. Am I willing to compromise what I know is right and what's true and what's real and what God is shaping me and sharing with me to be and what he wants me to say? Am I compromising the truth so that I can live comfortably and blend in with the world that I live in? We see this everywhere. We see compromise of integrity in sports. We see compromise of integrity in business. We see compromise of integrity, say it isn't so, in the church. We see compromise of integrity all over our world. The compromise of the truth so that we can be popular or self-fulfilled. Does integrity and character even matter anymore? Do we even care or know what the truth is? Are we willing to dismiss truth for lies, which the Bible says in the end times people will be dismissing the truth for the lie, and they want their ears to be tickled? Does integrity and character even matter anymore? Are we compromising, dismissing what we know to be true so that we can be right? In this season and every season of life that people have lived in, this is a conversation that mattered. For us in this season, for us living in this season, Esther reminded me this week, the book of Esther reminded me, that we were born for a season just like this. You're here for a reason. God wants to use you so that he can inject his truth into the world. Let me say it again, because some of you guys didn't seem impressed. He wants to use you to inject his truth into his world. Isn't that beautiful? He wants to use you to accomplish his mission in this world, which is his world, his people who he loves. He wants to see those people fall on their faces before him and worship him. And he's saying, hey, the church is the avenue. The church is the way we're going to accomplish that. That through you, through believers, through your integrity, through your character, through your uncompromisable living and obedience to the scriptures, to your radically sold out lifestyle, to who Christ is, that's who's going to share Christ with the world. You get the chance to be a part of that. We joked yesterday, the Packers really have a terrible punt return game and kickoff game. You didn't think I was going to get through a sermon without talking about this a few times, did you? They really do. We feel like they just find the person that looks the most athletic that walks into the stadium that day and says, would you like to return punts today? Wouldn't it be cool to be chosen? I think my brother even said, what if they just said, I'll give you $100,000 if you'll just return one punt? I was like, how much for two? I'll take the shot. For them to choose me to put on the jersey, to run down the field, get smashed at the 5-yard line, wherever, I'm not going to go anywhere. But just to represent the team one time, to put the jersey on, to get on the field, to look up in the air and just know the ball's coming and then see the team coming at me and you hear the crowd yelling and just, you were chosen to represent the team, to return a kick and probably die that day. But you get $100,000 and you represent the team. I hope you kind of look above that and beyond that to see you were chosen. You walked into the stadium and God said, yes, there they are, each one of those. They were chosen. You were chosen for a purpose, for a time, just like now, to represent him. He's having the conversation with you. And right now, I know he's having the conversation with you, stirring you and challenging you to say, man, what's more important to you, knowing that you're right and your political affiliation gets represented, or that I'm represented? I can't hardly believe that something as silly as politics has disrupted our faith. I can't believe it. Lord, help us. We've turned to a system instead of you. You've been chosen for a time just like this. Matthew chapter 5, verse 48. Many of you are probably familiar with this passage. Integrity has a lot to do with the word for integrity. Has a lot to do with uprightness and completeness, fullness, innocence, and blameless. And it reminded me of another word that Scripture uses quite often. Matthew uses the word completeness and perfection. In Matthew chapter 5, verse 48, he says this: therefore you are to be perfect. These are Jesus' words. Therefore you are to be perfect as your heavenly Father is perfect. When you're talking about integrity and you're talking about character, the word perfect, the Greek word teleos in this passage means completeness or fullness. Complete human integrity and virtue. Full growth. Teleos. Perfection. Completeness. You can quickly transition that word to a word that we use in this church, and the word is used in the Scriptures, and God challenges us to the word in Leviticus chapter 19 when he says for us to be holy. And so now we're not just talking about earthly integrity and doing business in a manner that is respectful and kind. But church, we're now talking about every action and reaction and response that we live with lines up with representation of God in being holy. Being a person of character and integrity, being a person who is mature, who is blameless, who is innocent and who's upright. All those things are connected to godliness, and godliness is connected to holiness. And God says, you are to be holy, for I am holy. I'm set apart. I want you to be set apart for holy purposes. You see how integrity matters so much? You see how it makes a difference in how we live and how we respond in our world? You see how just writing something and something innocent that maybe you think is innocent, can, if you're not thinking about those on the other side of you, if you're not thinking about those who think differently than you, if you respond in a manner that doesn't think about each other greater than yourself, how it leads to some of this lifestyle and some of this this destruction of our integrity and the destruction of our morality and the destruction of our character. And eventually it walks us away from God and a life of holiness and being obedient to what God is saying, that I want you to be a people who are set apart for my purposes, not your own. There's no room for that. There's no room for self-centeredness, fulfilling your own fleshly desires. There's no room for that. God calls us to holiness. I'm going to ask Jay if you'd come back this morning and help me as we conclude. But I think it's important when you throw a message like this at all of us, me too, it's important for us to take some time to respond. So would you stand with me this morning? We're going to sing through a song today, and then we're going to we're gonna have prayer, and then we're gonna sing through a song. And every time we're together, we have an opportunity to respond to the Holy Spirit. And something that the Lord has said to you today, maybe it's a challenge that He used me to say. Maybe it's through a song. Maybe it's through prayer time. Maybe it's something else that God Himself has prompted in your heart. This is your chance to respond to that. I trust and pray that you'll respond to that. And if you would like to talk to me sometime this week, I start taking new meetings on Monday. I got to start the new meetings Mondays. I would love to talk to you. I'd love to understand your story. I'd love to help us walk through this season with integrity, with character. We need each other. One of the reasons that we really felt compelled and passionate about being back to church together is we recognize after 2,000 years of Christianity, the body of believers is important. Amen? I think you believe that or you wouldn't be here this morning. The body's important and we need each other. We don't want to do this life on our own. There's no reason to. God has put people in our paths. He's put people next to you and in front of you and behind you. He wants you to share with them. He wants you to be honest with them. He wants you to confess to them. This is all biblical, scriptural things. Pray that you'll find somebody, maybe not right now this morning, but somebody that you can walk through life with and the difficulties and the struggles. I'll help you hold the plumb line of what character and integrity looks like. Father, would you just be with us this morning as you have been? Lord, this has been a challenging message, and there's been a lot challenging about this whole thing, and it challenges my lifestyle, my attitude, and my politics. It challenges everything about me, Lord, and I know it challenges everything about us as a body of believers and as American people. Lord, I just pray today that you would help us submit everything else. Surrender everything else that doesn't represent you. That we'd seek you first, your kingdom. As you reminded us that everything else comes after that. Doesn't mean there's not room for the things of the world, Lord. We know we live in the world. We participate in these things. We're governed by this body, so we're under their authority too. God, may our integrity and our character reside in you. May truth come from you and you alone. And when your truth conflicts with the world, Lord, I pray we'd have the courage to choose the truth, to choose you. When our own fleshly desires conflict with what your word says, even loving others, choose others greater than ourselves, God. Speak to us, Jesus, I pray. Help us in this season. Help us to know we've been called by your name. We've been labeled by you already. New Jersey has no room for other teams. Thank you, Jesus, for all that you do and all that you're going to continue to do. In Jesus' name.
Just because he lives.
how sweet to hold a newborn baby and feel the pride and the joy he gives. But greater still,
is worth the living just because he lives. There are so many narratives that compete to take hold in our lives, and so I was reminded this morning that with so many things that we in this world tries to shape and justify as Christian principles, we know one thing for sure. Like the song we sang this morning, there has never been and there will never be a God that loves us like our God does. And there will never be a love as true as the love that God has for us. And I'm reminded this morning that our God, no matter how the world tries to shape him, our God is not a God of hatefulness. Our God is not a guy that justifies evil. Our God is not a God, or our God is a God who wants us to preach truth, who wants us to preach and practice love, who wants us to put others first. And our God says that it takes more than just words, that it's also actions. And our God is a God who loves us, loves his children, and calls us to love his children well. This morning, before we leave, I want to read a blessing. And so if you'll hold your hands out this morning to receive that. Now may the God of peace, who brought back from the dead our Lord Jesus, the great shepherd of sheep, by the blood of eternal covenant, make you complete in everything good, so that you may do his will, working among us that which is pleasing to his sight, through Jesus Christ, to whom the glory forever and ever. Amen. go in peace this morning. We do ask, as it's getting warmer, if you want to fellowship outside, we do want to go ahead and disinfect everything. It was great to see you guys this morning. I'm glad that we're able to worship together.